I started selling drugs when I was in sixth grade. I was actually selling drugs just to afford to eat. I spent time in foster homes. I got abused in the foster homes. I got neglected in the foster homes. So for me to take it in my own hands was the only thing I felt was right to do at the time. So when I was about 11, I spent the next 3 to 6 months in and out of a football stadium, living there, and I was kind of taken in by the local hoodlums. You know, I went around with them, kind of learning their ways of doing things. We spent a lot of nights in stores and, you know, in back alleys, jumping people for whatever they had on them, kind of take what I needed because nobody else was going to give it to me. I went all out, started selling very large scale, and it was very easy to grow in that lifestyle rapidly. So about the time I turned 23, I was realizing that this is rapidly coming to a head, and I'm either gonna be dead or I'm gonna be in prison. So I decide I'm gonna sell my drug business to other dealers. One of them had gotten arrested and turned state's evidence. So they raid me on Thursday at 6 p.m. So that puts me in jail off and on for the next 2.5 years on pretrial. So in the beginning, when I first got put in prison, I would reach out to my friends and family, and rapidly everybody stopped answering. So at that point, I had no one, no visitors, no friends, no family. It was just me and the prison. For me, it was the lowest point in my life. I had nothing. Showering with other men, living in a room with another man. It's very sobering. So after I realize I have nothing left, I do what I do best. I turn back to the lifestyle that I know. So I join a gang. I become a soldier. And in that, we go to church. We go to this Christian service every Sunday because that's the only place that all the cell blocks get together. So fast forward about 1.5 years into going through these services, this one pastor come in, and I wasn't paying attention to him as I did the other pastor every other week. And shortly into him speaking, I'm not paying attention, but yet every word he's saying is being thrown right at me like daggers, and they're hitting me. Ultimately, I pick up a Bible and try to follow him through this word. And he says, if anybody hasn't accepted Christ, please come up and accept Christ. I have nothing, I have no one. And yet, here's the word asking me to trust him. I've trusted everybody else. Everybody else has failed me. Why not? So at that point, I walked forward and I accepted Christ. My life changed forever. So I took the Bible back to my cell, sat on my bed, and I opened it at Genesis 1. And I started reading. And I just find myself enthralled. I can't get enough. I get more and more pulled into the word, into the book. I can't stop reading. The way our cells are set up, this is a top bunk and a bottom bunk. Nobody ever wants the top bunk because the floodlights from the yard, from the perimeter, shine in and they keep you up all night. And now all of a sudden I find it a blessing because this light is exactly what I need to read. All day, all night, all I did was read the Bible. I would leave my cell to eat and to shower and then back into the cell into the Bible. So you fast forward to today, 16 years later, I've got a wife, I've got children, I've got the most amazing group of Christians that I work with, that I volunteer with. I've been blessed with not only salvation, but I've been blessed with a lifestyle. I was in a place, sitting in prison. I was at the bottom of a pit that this shouldn't have been a way out of. And that's when I realized there's nothing me or anyone can do that is too far to be saved.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. What a story. I love that guy. You know, Pete is on our staff now, and I just love him. I'm thankful for his faith. I'm thankful. Here's a man who has a life-changing relationship with Jesus. Amen? Amen. Let's thank God one more time for the miracle God did in his life. Awesome. Wow. Wow. Well, let me welcome everybody who's with us at our East Campus on the east side of town, downtown, Midway, Effingham, Statesboro. My friends up in Massachusetts who are watching us on the web every week. By the way, I met your grandson last Wednesday night. He's doing great over at our Statesboro campus. Thanks for supporting us in Mass. For all of us here who are at the Henderson campus, welcome, welcome. Listen, we started a new series of messages last week called How to Do What You Just Can't Do. And we're discovering how to leverage spiritual power for things that we know that we don't have the juice to handle on our own. And we all know what it's like to get hit with a situation that's way too much for us. And so the thought that there may be some spiritual resources available that could help, dude, that's good news, right? Now, last week we talked about life-changing prayer. Today we're going to talk about the mentoring power of Scripture. Now, you just heard a guy talk about how God changed his life in the joint through the Word. And let me tell you, he changed my life. I can't tell you how many times I've benefited from being mentored by the Bible last week. So let me just try to share some situations last week where I would not have known what to say if I had not been mentored by the Bible. I was at a party last Friday night. It's a birthday party with a bunch of friends, pretty much all of them from right here at church. One of my buddies was celebrating his 60th birthday, and of course, that's a big day. And I love old people, y'all. I love old people. And that's a big birthday. He didn't want anybody to know about it. So happy birthday, Dave. But anyway, we're having a good time. I'm eating a Cuban sandwich, which was awesome. And then a friend from church comes over and says, "Hey, Pastor, can I ask you a question?" I'm like, "Sure, man, sit down." He starts telling me about his parents, who are first-generation immigrants from Vietnam. They love the Lord. They're followers of Jesus. They're all set with that. But apparently, they are conflicted by two apparently contradictory concepts in the Bible. On the one hand, they've asked Jesus to be their Lord and Savior, their forgiver, their leader, and they're in the church, and they're good. They're followers of Christ. But on the other hand, they read this passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. It talks about sins that you can commit that will keep you out of heaven. You know, it says people who do these things will not be in heaven. And so they're like, so what if I committed one of those sins? What does that mean? And I remember the Apostle Paul talking to me about this very thing one day. So I told my friend at the birthday party the other night exactly what the Apostle Paul told me. He told me, "Cam, there is now no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus." Now, no condemnation. Now, before, everybody was condemned. Everybody feels condemned. Everybody is condemned because of our, you know, propensity to sin and the amount of sin in our lives. But once you are in Christ, no condemnation for you. Whew, right? Now, because Paul mentored me, I was able to explain to my friend that the passage he was talking about in 1 Corinthians 6 characterized a person's life before they were saved by Jesus. But man, when you become a follower of Jesus, you may still commit sin, but you know it's sin, you're sorry about it, you know, you ask the Lord to forgive you and all that. But the truth is, you are adopted into his family because he died for all of your sins on the cross. Consequently, all of your sins have been forgiven, past, present, and future. Anybody want to say amen? Amen. Whoo, praise the Lord, right? Which is why Paul would say in Romans 8:1, there is now, used to be different, but it is now, there is now no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. But I was so thankful. I was so thankful that my mentor, the Apostle Paul, sat me down and gave me this one-liner, this one leadership line to help me understand that once you are a follower of Jesus, you do not have to live in fear of hell, period, because you have a life-changing relationship with Jesus. Next day, my buddy, Joseph Weatherby, goes to be with the Lord. Joseph has been in a wheelchair his entire life. He lived through, frankly, 29 years of just brutal, brutal physical disability. The day that Joseph appeared in heaven was the best day of his life. I mean, he's living a life at a level he's never had before. I know that because I was talking with the Apostle John about this years ago. And the Apostle John assured me that blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, not cursed, robbed, imprisoned, disenfranchised, sad. No, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Now, John went on to remind me that if you're a follower of Jesus, when you die and you go to heaven, you get to rest from your labors. And I'm thinking, dude, all the agony and the physical pain that Joseph is just not even experiencing now. That is amazing. Then John told me, look, not only that, but the good deeds that you did on earth follow you to heaven. So somehow the reputation that we establish on earth actually makes a difference somehow in heaven. And I was like, wow, that is good news for Joseph, because frankly, Joseph Weatherby was one of the most positive, kind, courageous men I know. I mean, that brother patiently endured suffering with a level of courage that I find inspiring. So I felt great about Joseph, and then I saw his mama, and she is just overcome with grief. So, man, I gave her a big hug, and while I was hugging her, I whispered words of assurance to her based on this conversation I had with the Apostle John that Joseph is okay. He's more okay today than he ever has been. And you're going to be okay, because Jesus' best friend told me years ago, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Amen? Amen. I was so glad I memorized that one line when I learned it years and years and years ago. Then I open my email and I get this letter from this lady who is hot. And she is, I don't mean hot in a good way either. I mean, she's mad at me. She's mad. She's mad at me. You know why she's mad at me? Because she's bad. No, I'm bad. She is bad. All right, forget that. She thinks I'm bad. She thinks the church is terrible because we take up an offering every week and we ask people to give generously of their time and money, and that makes her unhappy because she didn't want to give any money and she didn't even want to hear about it. And my impulse was to answer that email. Well, ma'am, that's a pretty short-sighted conclusion to draw while you're sitting in a comfortable climate-controlled building that other people paid for, and your kid is sitting in a wonderful children's ministry environment that other people paid for, just hoping you and your kid would come to church here one day, while at the same time we're feeding starving kids in Africa, helping 1,000 families a month who are poor in our city through our Lighthouse ministry. Man, we are taking care of orphans, widows, refugees, been doing it nonstop for 50 years because of people who do want to be generous. No. Don't encourage, no. Do not encourage me. I don't need encouragement. No. That's what I wanted to write, okay? But I was talking to King Solomon about this very thing just a few years ago, and King Solomon told me something that has affected every email I have answered in the last 20 years. He said, Cam, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Friends, that one line represents some of the best emotional intelligence counsel I have ever received in my life. Solomon said, Cam, bro, you want to run her off or you want to win her over? Because when you're abrasive, you're never persuasive. So dial it down, big guy. And I'm like, well, Solomon, yeah, but how am I going to zing her if I dial it down? He's like, Cam, do you want to zing her or do you want to show love to her? And I thought, all right, Solomon, you win. So I went home, Sarah fixed me a nice meal, got a good night's rest, came back the next morning, answered the email like a Christian with a much more godly tone, you know, which was great. Friends, I'm so glad that when my turbines were spooling up, that leadership line came to my mind, because listen, Solomon had me memorize this line years and years. This is the best marriage advice I have ever received in my life. Best marriage advice I've ever received in my life. And Solomon had me memorize that years ago. I appreciate it. Now, I hope at this point, you're beginning to perceive the value of memorizing scripture, just having it in your head. I mean, here's the deal. We can literally be mentored in the moment by some of the wisest women and men who have ever lived throughout all of human history simply because we memorized a leadership line that we learned from them in the Bible. Man, I had a leadership line that helped my friend whose parents were confused. It was in my mind at a birthday party when I needed it because I'd memorized it. I had a leadership line that helped me help a grieving mama on the worst day of her life because it was in my mind when I needed it because I memorized it. Now, friends, here's how it works. Reading scripture provides information. You know, I'm in a life group, and we're a life group, and we're trying to read through the entire Bible this year. Many of y'all are doing the same thing with me. It's a lot of fun. 3 chapters a day. Boom, 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 boom. We are going through the Bible like this, man. It's great. It's awesome. Read through the whole Bible in 2017. Awesome. but not awesome enough. Not awesome enough, because reading gives you information. Reflecting on Scripture gives you formation. Now, while I'm trying to race through the Bible, that's good, because I want that information in my head, but I need to remember that as I'm reading, God is trying to form Christ in me. And so just like Joseph said, just like Pete said happened to him in prison, man, you read through the Bible and all of a sudden, boom, you get hit, right? I mean, you get hit by this verse, so I want to stop and I want to highlight that verse. And then, you know, I want to try to write it down on a little card somewhere. I got a card somewhere. I don't know where it is. There it is. Write it down on a card like this. And I put it on this card in my handwriting. So I've had to write it out. I can think about it. I know what this means now. And then I put it in my truck. And every time I get in my truck, I look at it. I put it on my desk so I can reflect on this insight that God hit me with while I was racing through the Bible. I can ruminate on this. You know what that means? That's the technical term for a cow that chews his cud, right? I can ruminate on this because the point is not for me to get through the Bible. The point is for the Bible to get through me, right? Now, reading gives you information, reflecting gives you formation. Memorizing Scripture provides transformation. Now, that's when you really start seeing some traction. Friends, memorizing these leadership lines that hit you while you're reading, listen, that's like having a bullet in the chamber all the time. I mean, man, you memorize enough Scripture, you can walk into any situation and you have the tools to help no matter what kind of help is needed. There's a great passage of Scripture in 2 Timothy 3:16. How many of y'all got a Bible? Hold it up. Bring your Bible with you. You got it? Come on, hold it up. Rest of y'all going to trust me? Trusting souls. I wouldn't do that if I were you. But anyway, there's a blue Bible at all of our campuses. Turn to page 996. If not, I'll put it up on the screen for you. But look at this passage of Scripture. This is an amazing, such an amazing passage. We'll read it all together. Are y'all ready? Ready? Here we go. Big voice on all of our campuses now. Come on. All Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that, everybody say, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I love this passage. Man, it's so rich we could drill down here for an hour, but fortunately for you, we won't. All right? Here's what I do want you to see. It says, all Scripture is from God. Let's talk about the Old Testament and the New Testament. When it says that the Scripture is God-breathed, that is often translated inspired, which means that God mentors us through the folks that He inspired to write the books of the Old and the New Testament. And friends, they are unique. I mean, think about the Bible. 40 different authors over a 1,500-year period of time in three distinct languages, and yet all amazingly unified around one central theme, never contradicts itself. That theme is God is sending Jesus to save the world. It's amazing. Friends, there's not another book or collection of books in the world like the Bible. It's awesome. But the point here is that the Scripture is from God. So nothing God wants or says or approves will ever contradict what He says in the Scripture. Ever. Now, this is really important because you're going to meet people, and maybe it'll be you. You'll meet them in the mirror one day, and you're going to want something really, really bad, and you're going to really, really want it. And then you're going to have an experience or a dream or a feeling or meet some friend or whatever, and you're going to interpret that as God giving you permission to do something that contradicts the Scripture. This verse is in your Bible so that you will know that that voice, that vision, that friend, that feeling is not from God. It is not from God. He will never say anything to anybody that contradicts what He said in His Word. Never. Never. Now, because that's true, Scripture mentors us in really useful ways. I mean, it's amazing, man. You know, the Bible gives us these leadership lines that teach us. They teach us. You know, when my dad died suddenly at 43 years of age, I was 11. All the comfort that our family experienced as we grieved came from promises that we have been taught from the Word of God. We learned where my daddy is today. We learned what heaven's going to be like. We learned how the Holy Spirit will bless us in a time of grief. We learned how the peace of God will bless us if we sought it. And we learned all of that because we were taught from the Bible. Now, friends, the Apostle Paul taught me, and I bet I have prayed this leadership line 1,000 times since my dad died in 1967. He taught me a line that was really helpful. Every time I talk to anybody who's going through grief, I'll say, let me pray for you. And here's what I'll pray. Lord, I just pray that the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, will guard this family's hearts and minds in Christ Jesus as they walk through this valley of the shadow of death. God, make your presence a real tactile thing in their life. Friends, I pray that prayer for everybody I meet who's grieving. And sometimes, I'm telling you, I can feel the tension just go out of them as I'm praying that prayer. They just relax as they are reminded of something that Paul mentored me on years ago when my dad died. And I memorized that verse, that line, one line. And so I got it ready every time that leadership line is needed. Sometimes the scripture rebukes us. It teaches us, but it also rebukes us. Listen, when I got that email dog in our church, and I started heating up, King Solomon said, calm down, son. What's he doing? Rebuke me. He rebuked me. Cam, that response is inappropriate for a godly man. That is inappropriate for a loving person. Why? Why is it inappropriate? Well, because the word of God says a harsh word stirs up anger. My buddy James, the brother of Jesus, told me the same thing years ago. Cam, the anger of man, and I've struggled with anger all my life, the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. One line. That's all it was. But wow, I'm so glad I memorized that leadership line because they helped me so much when I need it the most. Interestingly, internalizing scripture also corrects me when I need it. Now, this makes sense. Cam, you're all amped up. Calm down, son. You're getting ready to get off in the weeds here. Why don't you correct your attitude a little bit? That makes sense. But this word actually has a much deeper meaning than that. I don't know if you've ever wrecked a car before, but it's amazing how badly you can wreck up a car and then you take it to a really good body shop, and man, 2 or 3 weeks later, bada bing, bada boom, they restore that thing to full beauty and full function. It's awesome. My Sarah went through one of those crazy years last year where her car got hit by other cars 3 times in 9 months. That car was in the shop 3 months out of those 9 months. You see this shoestring right here? I took that off my boot to tie the grill up so we could get that thing back home and get it to the shop after some heathen tried to kill my godly wife on the road, all right? But now here's the point. She told me, she said, Cam, none of these are my fault. I'm like, I'm pretty sure that's true, baby. Especially since Garrett was driving one time. But anyhow, you know, it's so sad to see your car all torn up, you know, the grill just ripped off the thing. But you take it to a great body shop, and a month or two later, okay, you know, however long it takes, but are you back in business, right? Now, here's the amazing thing. This is what memorizing these leadership lines from the Bible can do for your life. Man, you get all torn up with anger, and the Lord will restore you. Cam, bear with one another and forgive one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Okay, well, if I'm gonna forgive the way I've been forgiven, I guess I can't be holding any grudges against so-and-so. You get all torn up with selfishness, he repairs your heart, makes you more thoughtful. Cam, let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. You get all torn up with worry, he polishes you out until you have peace. Don't be anxious about anything, but present your request to God. You get all torn up with fear, he corrects your stance, man. He makes you confident. Fear not, for I am with you, says the Lord. I mean, it might just be one line, but the outcome of that one line, the teaching and the rebuking and the correcting and then the restoration of God's dream for your life through that one line is that as a follower of Jesus, you are trained in righteousness so that the man or woman of God can be thoroughly equipped for every good work, anything, anytime, anywhere, good to go. And friends, let me tell you, memorizing those leadership lines is worth the effort. However much effort it takes, it's worth it. You know, Psalm 119:11 says, I have hidden your word in my heart, that's memorizing, so that I might not sin against you. Now, there's a guy that I know who left our church a couple years ago who recently committed adultery. And his family is in shambles. Shambles because of that sin. You know, sometimes when I talk to really busy people about this, they say, well, Cam, I just don't have time. Dude, I work hard, man. I don't have time for daily devotions. I don't have time to study the Bible. I don't have time to memorize these leadership lines. I just don't have the time. Well, let me ask you a time management question. How much time do you think it's going to take my buddy to dig his family out of the pit that he threw them in when he committed adultery? How much time you think it's going to take before his kids ever look at him the same again? 2 years? 3 years? 4 years? It ain't going to happen in 1 year. Only a fool would believe that. Dude, let me tell you, when you hide God's word in your heart in a way that keeps you from crossing that line and committing that kind of devastating sin, it doesn't cost you time. It saves you time. Big time. Amen? Now listen, this is why my mentor, the Apostle Paul, said, let the word of Christ dwell richly within you. Paul said, man, I want you to be so saturated with the word of God that in the moment of truth, man, when you caught off guard, I don't care if it's in the marketplace or in traffic or the grocery store or the school or in a hotel hallway while you're traveling on a business trip. No matter where you are, because you've hidden God's word deep in your heart, man, this Holy Spirit can bring a memorized leadership line into your mind so that hopefully a good outcome will occur rather than a bad one. So, as your pastor who loves you, let me feed you a few leadership lines so that you can prepare to engage everything in life with memorized scripture. Now, I'm going to give you a few categories where I think every compassionate Christian needs to be armed and ready all the time. And first of all, I think every Christ follower needs a few salvation leadership lines. Salvation leadership. Now, think about this. You get in a conversation, faith comes up. Somebody says, are you a Christian? You say, yes, I am. How'd you become a Christian? What do you say next? Well, you're going to tell them your story, which is great. But surely you're going to want to root that in the Bible somehow, right? You're going to want to share how what the Bible says operationalized itself in your life and your salvation. So what verse are you going to quote? What's your one-liner? Now, in my life group, we just memorized 1 John 5:11-12. Now, where's my guys? Eric Johnson out of Effingham, you can quote this verse. Come on. All right, I'm going to let y'all off the hook this time. But here's what it says. 1 John 5:11-12. This is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Now, here comes the big part. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God, Jesus, does not have life. Now, friends, this is how you became a Christian. This is the leadership line. He who has the Son has life. If you don't have a relationship with the Son of God, you do not have eternal life. I don't care whether you're American and go to church all the time or your mama had you baptized when you were a little wee baby. If you don't have a relationship with the Son, you do not have life. Let's read it all together, shall we? He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. I left out the Son of God. I do that every week. They correct me every Thursday morning for leaving that out. All right. Now, what does this mean? This means that believing in God is not enough. Believing in God is not enough. You need to know you got to have a relationship with Jesus if you want to have eternal life. Here's another great line written by Jesus, his best friend. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. Man, it's all about believing and receiving Jesus as the leader of your life and the forgiver of your sins. Man, you can't be saved by religion. Or having some loose connection with a religion somewhere, or having your name on a church roll somewhere, or mama got me, I'm on the family plan, or I got my stuff halfway together, or, you know, I'm a lot better than some of the Christians I know. That don't mean a thing. If you don't know Jesus, you are not saved. And if you do, you are. I love what Jesus said in Mark 16:16, because of the certainty of it. One line, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Does it say might be saved? No. Could be saved? No. Catch on a good day and be okay? No. If you put your faith in Jesus, been baptized into Christ, you should be confident. You should be confident that you will be saved. Man, belief in Jesus comes before everything else, and it changes everything else. Here's another great line that I love. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Here's the two operative words right here. If you have a life-changing relationship with Jesus, your old man, dead and gone, new person born again in Christ, all that sin of the old past, under the blood of Christ, new man, God doesn't even remember that stuff about you anymore. But it's because you're in Christ. It's because you did business with the Lord Jesus. So just pick one. Pick one of these verses and then just write it out on a card just like this and memorize it, put it in your truck, say it every day. And let me tell you, if you say that verse every day for a week, every week for a month, once a month for a year, you will never be able to forget it. It's awesome. It'll serve you well for the rest of your life. How about this line? Romans 10:13, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Are you a Christian? Yes, I am. How'd you get saved? Well, I was sitting in a chapel in prison one day, and I heard the gospel, And you know what? I called out to Jesus and asked him to be the Lord and Savior of my life, and he did, and I became a Christian right there. And then you tell him the rest of the story. Now, there are other verses in the Bible that might be, you know, more congruent with what happened for you, but here's the point. I want to encourage you to have in your mind all the time a salvation verse that you have memorized that tools you up to be able to tell somebody from Scripture how you came to a life-changing relationship with Jesus. I don't want you going through life scared to death you might get called on. All you got to do is memorize this verse and you're good to go, man. Have that one leadership in your mind and you will never hesitate to talk about God again because you'll be prepared. Right on the heels of that, I want to suggest that you memorize an assurance leadership line. Do you ever struggle with doubt about your relationship with the Lord? Do you ever struggle with doubt about that? I mean, generally when you do, it's because you're in some behavioral pattern that you know is wrong and you're out in the weeds and, you know, it's really eating on you a little bit. And it's kind of like when you're flying. I don't know if you do a lot of flying, but, you know, when you get to the gate in the airport, there's two kinds of people at every gate. There's people who have a boarding pass and there are people who are on standby. You know who you can tell, how you can tell the people who have a boarding pass? Because they sit in that gate like a cat. Like a cat. They just laid out, man. I got this. No problem. Give me some Starbucks. I'm going to drink a little cup of coffee. I'm going to wait for this airplane because I got my boarding pass right here. I got me a seat on this plane. The standby people, man, they're anxious. They're walking around. They're praying to Jesus. Come on, get me on this airplane, right? Because they don't have a seat yet. Can I just say that if you are in Christ, you have a seat in the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. You have a seat. You ain't on standby, brother. That's why John, Jesus' best friend, gave us this great line in 1 John 5:13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know, everybody say no, know. That you have eternal life. You shouldn't have to wonder about that. This is like, I hope so, or maybe so to you. No, confident. You know that you have eternal life. Now, if you struggle with that, maybe you need to memorize this line. All right, here's a twofer. We know we talked about 1 John 5:12. Let's focus on the verb this time instead of the subject. In 1 John 5:12, it says, whoever has the Son of God has life. Doesn't say you might have, could have, ought to have. If you have a relationship with Jesus, you have eternal life. If you don't, you don't. But man, this is a verse that gives us some confidence. One line that you can have in your mind. All right, here's another category. Temptation lines. Anybody here ever been tempted by sin before? Anybody here ever been tempted by sin? Those of you who didn't raise your hand, I'll be talking about lying next week. We'll get you. All right. You know what amazes me is some people think when they get their life all wrecked up, you know, and they talk to me and their life is just all mangled and all wrecked up because of sin. Here's what they think. Well, Cam, you know, my temptation is worse than everybody else's. My situation's unique. I'm in a different category from everybody else. So God's going to give me a special pass because my situation is more difficult than anybody else's. You know, there's actually a leadership line in the Bible that addresses that I was taught by the Apostle Paul years ago when I was making those same lame excuses. Here's what Paul told me. He said, Cam, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. Do you know what that means? You are not experiencing an undue number of temptations. You are not experiencing an undue intensity of temptation. You are just like everybody else. Quit whining and making excuses for your sin. God is faithful. Everybody say faithful. Faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Can you believe that? That the God who created this world has promised you, I will never let you get pushed beyond your ability to be faithful. That's a pretty cool promise. But, biggest word in the Bible right there. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. Every single time you face the heat of temptation, God will show you a way to bear up. Now, our D group just memorized this passage, and this is pure gold. You should memorize this, but this is not a one-liner, all right? This is a lot, and so you're going to have to man up to memorize this one. But there are some leadership lines that are just one line about temptation that I think will really help. James, the brother of Jesus, said, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You know how James knew that? Because his brother Jesus told him in Matthew chapter 4, man, I went out in the wilderness when I started my ministry and the devil came at me. And you know what I did, James? I took these Bible verses that I learned when me and you were little boys in the synagogue and beat him to death with those Bible verses. Resisted the devil and the devil had to flee. Here's another great line. Abstain from every form of evil. 10 o'clock at night, family's all doing something else, open the laptop, see a scantily dressed human being on the little side panel over there. Think about clicking that. Maybe you should just say this verse right here. abstain, say it with me, everybody, abstain from every form of evil. Or maybe if you're struggling, you should pray this prayer: Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Getting off the airplane in Las Vegas for that conference, pray it out loud because you're feeling the heat. Lord, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from this evil. Here's a verse, a one-line verse that I was taught by one of my mentors years ago that saved my marriage. Saved my marriage. Here it is. Flee sexual immorality. Say it with me, everybody. Flee sexual immorality. And you know what that is? Any sexual contact outside of the person you're married to. So that just covers it right there. Let me hear all of the single people, all of the young people, all the high school students, all the kids. I'm talking to you. Let's say this out loud right now. Y'all, big voice. Here we go. Flee sexual immorality. It's important throughout your entire life. Listen, when I was a young man, the only guy in the Bible that there's not a single negative word about other than Jesus sat me down and said, Cam, I want to teach you a couple things about women that you don't know, because I was interested in women. I've been looking at them. I was amazed by them. I wanted to talk to them, touch them, spend time with them. And he said, let me tell you a couple things about women that you don't know yet. Number one, there are women in this world who will show you all kind of attention who do not give a rip about you. This is a game they play, and you are just the dumb ox they are leading to slaughter. Anybody ever met one of those women? They're out there, bro. Here's what he told me next. If you ever think this is happening to you, think that this is happening to you, run! Run, man! Run, Forrest, run! Don't try to resist, just run, man! You know, the Bible says resist the devil. It says flee from sexual immorality. You know why? Because the devil's a lot easier to handle than a woman who got her eye on you, bro. So you need to go. Man, generally, you will recognize the devil, but he's got that blue dress on, woo, you just need to run, son. Now, that's all the old people caught that last line right there. You know what I'm talking about? But you know, he was right. And you know who that mentor was? His name was Joseph. Last half of the book of Genesis is his story. Godly man, fled sexual immorality. God promoted him to prime minister of Egypt because of his holiness. You know what? I was in Pennsylvania not long after that, preaching one weekend. And I had spoken at this church on the weekend, and about 10 o'clock in the morning, I was in my hotel room. I hear this knock on the door. I'm like, what in the world? I open the door. There's a woman standing there. She said, well, I got your hotel and room number and heard you last night at church, and is this one if you want to go get a cup of coffee? I looked back over my shoulder, and I saw Joseph back there going, run! Run! Get out of there, man! Come on, let's go! And I said, man, I'm sorry, I can't do it. I got my buddy back here. I got to go. Slammed the door. Man, I went back in there, called Sarah up on the phone. Baby, you're not going to believe what just happened to me. I told her the whole story. That little Norwegian girl got ready to come up to Pennsylvania and hurt that gal, man. She's going to hurt her. Now, she didn't do that, but she did amp up her prayers for me because I used a leadership line on myself to flee sexual temptation. That's what Joseph did. That's what you do too if you get it in your head. What about times of trial, when you're going through a time of trial? Any leadership lines there? You know, we talked last week about James 1 verse 2, so we won't go over that one again. But what about James chapter 1 verse 12, where James, the brother of Jesus, said, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Man, when you go through a hard time, don't quit, don't run, don't throw God under the bus. Patiently endure. Those are the people that God blesses. Now, if you want to be blessed by God when you're going through a hard time, lean in, get close, pray more, get spiritually tough, endure trials with him. You know, Romans 8:28 is probably the, you know, super text on enduring trials. It says, we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. Let's say it all together. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. Now, you know, when you go through a tough time, you're tempted to think, God don't love me no more. Or God's letting something bad happen to me because he doesn't care. Or maybe God caused this. Or maybe God took his eye off the ball. And you know that's stinking thinking. And if you go down that path very far, your hard time will get much, much harder. Which is why if you have this line in your mind, we know that God causes all things. He doesn't cause all things. He causes all things to work for good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Man, if you've got this line in your head, you can kind of repeat it to yourself, fill your faith tank, remind yourself that God didn't cause bad things, but he very often works through bad things to make good things happen for the people that he cares about, and he cares about you. Amen? All right, we're about out of time here, so let me just flash some stuff at you. You ready on this? Fear. Fear leadership lines when you get afraid. God did not give us a spirit of timidity. Man, that's not what God has in store for any of us. Listen, man, some of us have come out of such terrible backgrounds, such terrible homes, that we walk through life scared to death half the time. You know what that is? It's a wrecked up heart, a wrecked up soul that was wrecked up by other people that God wants to restore and refinish and buff out and make beautiful and confident, like the heart that He created you to have in the first place. God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power and love and self-discipline. Man, that's a verse some of y'all need to learn, and you need to start your day praising God for that every day. How about this verse? You've heard this before on television, at the Super Bowl. I can do all things through Him who gives me strength. I'm amazed at how many people who are performing at the highest levels, serving at the highest levels, playing at the highest levels, quote this verse to themselves at the Olympics, at the Super Bowl, wherever, because this promise of God quiets their fears. It's a leadership line. How about this one? If God is for us, who can be against us? I mean, listen, man, no matter what you're up against, if that leadership line is preloaded into your heart and mind, man, that turns pressure into peace. I mean, man, if God's for me, then why am I worrying about this? I wish I could teach on this for an hour, because let me tell you, there are leadership lines for wisdom and anger and contentment and peace and power, life-changing one-liners from our divine mentor that are already secured for us in the scripture. All you got to do is dig for it. All you got to do is mine for it. It's already there waiting on you. So the question you should all be asking right now is, so what? Say it, everybody. So what? Well, so I want to help you pick a discipline that will enable you to memorize leadership lines of scripture that will help you when you need help the most. I want to share with you some steps that will make memorizing doable. Notice I did not say easy. Memorizing scripture is not necessarily easy, but it is valuable and applicable and doable no matter how old you are. So, number one, start as young as possible. If you want to memorize scripture, start as young as possible, which means today for some of us, right? And if you have little kids, as young as possible. Kids, this is easy for them. You can sing a Bible verse to a kid and they'll remember when they're 50 years old. Listen, 2 years old. If you have a 2-year-old child, that child can memorize scripture. And if you can feed it to them and make it fun and put it to music or whatever, they will start memorizing scripture at 2 years old. Number two, unlock the power of repetition. You know, my life group just started memorizing about a half a dozen passages of scripture that go with this study we're doing on Thursday morning. Now, here's the funny thing. When we started, every one of those jokers were saying like, well, you know, I'll try, but I'm just telling you, I'm no good at memorizing stuff. I don't know if I can memorize it. I've tried. I don't know if I can. I'll try, but I'm not sure I can memorize anything. Of course, they know their phone number. They know their address, spouse's address, spouse's birthday, anniversary, social security number, bank password, ATM code. You know what I'm talking about? We memorize stuff we use because we want to. We memorize stuff we use because we want to memorize it. Now, here's the thing. We say all of these Bible verses to each other every Thursday morning, and if you get one word wrong, we just dog the tar out of each other, right? And what's funny is that here we are a month later, all these guys who said, I can't memorize anything, are now saying these memory verses from memory perfectly with confidence every week. Now, the cool thing about memorizing something for Thursday morning is that it's in your head for Thursday afternoon and Friday afternoon and Saturday afternoon at the hospital and Sunday afternoon at the funeral home and Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday as well. It's in your head, man. Now, we're able to do this because of repetition. Now, we wrote our verses down on cards like this, just the back of a business card. That's all that is. And we keep them in the truck and we just flip through them and say them out loud every day. And that's how we learned them. The third thing I would encourage you to do is memorize in little bites. Little bites. Now, if you want to memorize 2 Timothy 1:7, there are two great tactics for doing that. Here's number one. You read this verse out loud 6 times, and you will be able to say it from memory the 7th time. Try it, and you'll see. You read it out loud 6 times, you'll be able to say it from memory the 7th time. If you write it down on a card, and then you look at it and you say it every day within a week, you'll be able to say this just like the best preacher you know, all right? Now let's try it. We'll just do it 1 time and say the address as well, because you know how frustrating it is to know something's in the Bible, but you don't know where it is. We're gonna fix that. Here we go, big voice, everybody. God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love, and self-discipline. Now, when you memorize it, you got to say it out loud. And if you say it out loud, you'll figure out what it means. Now, let's do the address. 2 Timothy 1:7. Now, you try this, and you'll be able to, you say it out loud 6 times, you'll be able to say it from memory the 7th time. If not, you're trying to do too much. So break it in half. God did not give us a spirit of timidity. Say that out loud 6 times. You'll be able to say it the 7th time from memory. Then do the rest of it. Put them both together. You'll be good to go. All right? That's one way to memorize scripture. The other way is what we call the skip method. All right? The skip method. Now, let's try this one more time. Say it with me, this verse right here and the address. Big voice. Come on now. God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love, and of self-discipline. 2 Timothy 1:7. Now, let's say it again. Go ahead. Now let's say it again. God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love, and of self-discipline. 2 Timothy 1:7. You're learning already. Let's try it one more time, shall we? Here we go. God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love, and of self-discipline. 2 Timothy 1:7. Now listen, you can keep going like this until you have this verse down. And you should. Because now it's on you. You know how to do it. You know how to arm yourself. You ever been to a gunfight with a knife? That ain't much fun. I'm using a lot of violent metaphors for Bible memorization here today. But you know, when you carry the sword of the Spirit on you all the time, it's like going to a fist fight with a sword. Because you get in a fist fight with the devil every day, right? And if you're armed, dude, you have the advantage. Now, pick out a couple of these leadership lines. On your note sheet, look at your note sheet one more time. On your note sheet, I have given you 37 verses of scripture. 37. Every verse I've quoted today is on this note sheet. They're one-liners, almost all of them. Pick out, listen, 37. You could memorize all of these in the next year if you just memorized one a week and then wrote it out on a card like this and kept that stack of cards in your car and went through them every day on your way to work. I'm just telling you, it would be easy to do. And if you do that, you will never walk into a battle unarmed ever again. Or not. And then you just limp through your spiritual life feeling weak, feeling regret, hoping nobody calls on me. Why would you do that? Listen, you have already memorized thousands of lines. Anybody here know any movie lines? Huh? Sports lines? Fashion lines? Laugh lines? Why don't you memorize some leadership lines? Memorize something that will make a difference in the world forever. I heard a story this week about a 2-year-old kid who drowned, and it's just horrible. I mean, it's hard to even imagine the tragedy and the grief that those parents had to process. But as they were preparing for the funeral, they told their pastor about their son's memory verse. Their son had a leadership line that he had learned at church. And they gave him a little paper at church, which your kids will all have little papers of stuff that they've been learning at church when they walk out the door today, because we teach here, we don't babysit, we teach. And they had taught him Psalm 119, 160. Jacob was mentored by King David at church and told, all God's words are true. This is what he learned at church. All your words are true. And so when he came home with that paper, he can't read, now he's two, but he said, all your words are true. And his parents were so impressed, they put that up on the refrigerator, and every time he walked by the refrigerator, he can't read, but he would see that paper and he'd go, all your words are true. And they would hit the refrigerator. The preacher in the making right there, right? All your words are true. So at the funeral, the pastor explained how this little boy had been mentored by King David and taught to trust the Lord at 2. And so here's what they did at the funeral, and here's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to read you some promises from God's Word, and I want you to respond like little Jacob did with this leadership line. Are y'all ready? He heals the brokenhearted. Jesus said, come unto me, all you who are weak and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Sometimes we don't know how we ought to pray, but the Holy Spirit intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Dude, you load your heart with these leadership lines from the Bible, and they will serve you well beyond the rest of your life. Amen? Amen. It's true. Father, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity we've had to be together today, and Lord, for your word. And we've really run through a lot of it. And I pray, God, that all of us will leave this room determined that these lines are going to stick in our head. And so we'll be ready to use them whenever the need arises. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. All right.